everlasting, unending love, because that's his way. That's his nature. That's who he is. Praise God. I'm glad you came to worship today. Praise God. You can relax and be seated. Thank you. The worship team, you did a great job. Thank you for blessing us in a powerful way. Amen. Whoa. I can see you now. Look at that. You're here. I thought you might have left when I stood up there. If the monitors are giving you problems, shut them right off, because I don't need to hear me preach. I already know what I'm going to say. Work with the audience. This is going to be a great week. Do you know it? God has amazing things in store for us because he's an amazing God. And whenever Jesus comes, special things always happen. That's going to happen for you this week. I mean, it might as well happen for you. If it can happen for anybody, hello, it can happen for you. Praise the Lord. So you want to look for that, because that's how a person really connects with God. They don't get up and see him as a generic God who can bless the whole world. But that doesn't take you anywhere. You need to get personal on this thing. Sure, he's going to bless the whole world, but you're the one he's targeted in on today. He saw you and you came into the room, and he's looking to do something extraordinary for you. I believe that about God, and if no one else will get it, then I'll just take it myself. Share that kind of approach or attitude with me, if you will. Let me give you a little idea of what's going to be coming down. Maybe I should just take a few seconds, if you will. Allow me to introduce myself. I just want to tell you something about Dale Everett. One of the things that you should know about me is that I am saved. It's a good thing to know the guy that's preaching to you is saved, isn't that right? You know, I had, in the first phase of my life, the early stages, God began to open his heart to me. In that I had my moment of repentance when I was 7 years of age. I remember I received the call to this ministry when I was 8 years of age. And then I received the Holy Ghost. That's going to happen this morning for people, when I was 9 years of age. Yeah, did you hear that? I also understood the first direct, specific aspect of this ministry. When he called me, he didn't tell me everything he wanted me to do. He just let me know I would serve him in full-time ministry. But when I hit 12 years of age, I was sitting out in a camp meeting. Does anyone know about those things? Yeah, I was sitting out in a camp meeting when the voice of the Lord came to me. How many believes God talks in church? I believe he does. I believe he talks in church. I don't think he texts, so you can turn your phone off. Well, he did text one time, didn't he? But it was before smartphones, so he had to use the wall. Remember that? Yeah, but you didn't want to get that message, so turn your phone off anyhow. Yeah, let me tell you, that was not a good message. But he spoke to me very early on, and he said to me, I want you to be an evangelist in North America. And that's what would begin the first 22 years of this ministry. Between that age of 12 and 15 is when he kept coming to me again and again and again. And when he was saying these words to me, he said, Dale, I want you to heal the sick and cast out devils. You know, I was doing pretty good up to that point. Up to that point, I was moving right. I was trekking just great. But when he said, I want you to heal the sick and cast out devils, man. Now, not that I didn't believe in that stuff. I believed in it. I just couldn't see me doing it. Hello? Am I talking to anybody else in the room? And so he stuck with it, though. He kept saying that. Every time I would meet with him in prayer, he'd say that same thing to me. I want you to heal the sick and cast out devils. And let me just say it to you. That's why I finally believed it. You know, God has something for you today, but if you don't believe it, you won't embrace it. You don't empower him to do it by your faith, but you do open your heart to it. Now, that was worth a whole message right there. That's true. We could have taken an offering right there, and it would have been worth the whole morning. But he spoke those words to me, and then when I finally grasped it, when I finally embraced it, and I had a moment with God. I was under the power of God for probably about 2 straight hours, and again, another one of those camp meeting kind of moments. And when I left that place of prayer, I knew I seen the length and breadth of this ministry. I think they told me last Sunday they showed you a video of one of our African crusades. Is that right? Did anyone see that? I saw that stuff when I was right at my 15th year of life. And I didn't start with that. I started right here at home in North America. But that's what he showed me. He showed me all of that. And then the moment I saw it, and I want you to listen to these words, the moment I saw it and embraced it, The moment I saw it and embraced it, let me see how I can say that another way. Oh, I know. The moment I saw it and embraced it. See, because he'd said those things before, but I wasn't buying it. When I bought into it, to my great surprise, I thought this all would happen way later. You know, I mean, I was 15, so I knew, you know, you had to finish high school and you need to go to, you know, Bible school, or if you really want to be a big dog, go to seminary, you know, or do something like that. And then you got to have life experience, because you're not worth a toot without life experience. But I thought, well, after all that has happened, then this thing will finally open up, you know, when I'm an adult, when I'm old, 30. Hello. How many knew when you were 15, even anyone that was 28 looked like they were at least a cousin to the Ancient of Days? Isn't that true? But little did I know that the moment I would embrace it, it would start happening. And at 15 years of age, this grace of God opened to me to do what I'm going to be doing with you this week, and I started traveling the U.S. at 15. And continued for 22 straight years as an evangelist doing that. Finished my high school education, but I mean, I did my Bible school teaching by education by correspondence, and I just traveled the nation. And then I got married during that time. Oh, by the way, the end of this month, I'm gonna be preparing to leave for Africa. I'll be leaving on August 1st. I go back to Africa. I'll not be leaving on July 31st. I'll be leaving on August 31st. August 1st. Would someone say not July, but August? And the reason why I'm not leaving on July, because at the end of July, I'll be celebrating my wedding anniversary of 34 years. Yeah. So I know that if I leave on July 31st, I will not be celebrating the 35th year. And since I like what I'm doing here with this lady, I think I'm just going to hang in there. I traveled for about 22 straight years, and then the Lord opened the door and put me into the position of a pastor, and I did that for a while. I pastored two existing churches, churches that have been around longer than I've been alive, and then a man by the name of R.W. Schambach, some of you might know who he is. He's going on to be with the Lord, an elderly gentleman. Probably a lot of the young people don't know who I'm speaking of, but that great man of God and I had been friends for a great number of years, and he knew of the touch of God in my life that was similar to his, not in style of preaching, but in faith for miracles and deliverance. And he said, would you come to Texas and plant a church on my property before I pass on, because I want to have a church left that would be a legacy to the type of faith that I follow in. And so that's what I did. I worked with him the last 8 years of his life. We planted that church. And then about eight years ago, the Spirit of God spoke to me. He said, I'm going to take you to the nations of the world. And that's basically where we're at. So I travel about 7 months in the U.S. Doing this, where God has given me favor. And the areas of favor that God has given me are three. I got three areas of strong favor. Now, you got to know, last month began the 45th year of this ministry, and in 45 years, you've done more than three things, all right? But there are three things that he's given me greater grace in, is the way I'd like to say it. One is to call people to repentance. Can I tell you that just from November to November, we prayed with over 50,000 recorded decisions to receive Jesus Christ as Lord? Amen. The other area that he's given me great favor in is that of divine healing, and that's what the service tonight is going to be all about. We're believing God for extreme miracles in this house. One of the promises he made to me when I was a teenager, when I was 15, when I first started with this, and it was before I ever had my first crusade, when he opened the gift to me, I was actually working alongside of one of the old Voice of Healing evangelists, if that said anything to you guys, like Roberts or folks like that. And he said these words to me. He said, Dale, there will never be a time that you'll have a healing service, but what I'm going to heal people, and there will be people that will be visibly or identifiably healed. Can I tell you that in the 45 years of doing this, I've never seen it fail to happen anywhere we've been in the earth. Whether we've been in a church service, whether we're doing an open air meeting, whether I'm doing a hotel ballroom, no matter where it's at, if it's a healing service, if it's set apart for that, there's always people who get healed, and not people who get healed and you figure it out a month later. I mean, that's good too. I mean, good night, man. I'll tell you, you get healed of a blood disease or something, and you find out when you go to the doctor next month, you've got your miracle. Hello. Praise God. That'll be just fine. But he said that part of this ministry will be to demonstrate the kingdom. And he says, and there'll always be visible or identifiable healings that will happen in that very service. Can I tell you something that I know for sure? I know that in this room today, Jesus is going to heal people. I know that without a doubt. I know that without a doubt. And there's some of you that have come in pain today, but I'm going to tell you, when you lay your head on the pillow tonight, you will not be in pain, because our God is a healing God. He's a healing God. Praise God. Come on, he's a healing God. So you want to expect that, look for that. Most of the miracles that happen today in our services for over 30-some years, we'll talk more about that tonight because it'll be more pertinent to that service, but most of them happen in the beginning, and in fact, they exclusively happen through the laying on of hands. And then about 8 years ago, there came, to my surprise, not by my request, a shift in things, and God just began to heal people in the audience as we were preaching. And today, it doesn't happen exclusively that way, but about 99% of the time, it happens just like that. I probably lay hands on the sick maybe 6 times in an entire year, and I'm in services pretty well every week of the year. But I know I spend about 300 days in motel rooms. That's the reason why my wife isn't always with me. The guys didn't get that, but all the ladies got that right there. You got that right. And also, we have now got a 2-year-old grandson that lives about 5 minutes from us. And he has totally trumped me. Y'all understand what I just said there. But she does come to some of the meetings, just not all of them. But anyhow, that word of the Lord, when it came, he said, I'm going to work those miracles. And I've never seen him fail to do it. But today what's happening is people just get healed while we're preaching the word. By the time I'm through with the message tonight, I'm going to tell you the truth. By the time I'm through with the message tonight, there'll be anywhere from 20% to sometimes as much as 60% of the audience that will have gotten healed while they're just sitting there. Deaf ears will open up, a blind eye will open up. It'll just happen. And it'll happen all through the service. And of course, you all understand it anyhow. The reason why it's happening is not because hotshot evangelist came down to lay his hands on you, but it happens because Jesus is here. Come on, you know that's true. You know that's true. And that healing Jesus will be working among us. No doubt there will be someone that will even connect with it today, because it happens everywhere we go. But the focus today is on the third area that God has given me greater grace in, and that is to see every believer baptized in the Holy Ghost. Let me tell you, this will happen today, and it will happen. Are you ready for this one? It'll happen with ease. In fact, if you'll allow me today, I want to approach both the subject matter and the ministry of it a little bit different than what I grew up with. I want to say classical Pentecost, and I love classical Pentecost. That's in me to the bone. Okay, but I'm going to minister today, maybe in a way that will be a little more low key, maybe a little more casual, maybe coming from a direction that we quite haven't done it before. But I'll tell you today, God is going to baptize people in the Holy Ghost. It's an area that I have a great desire and hunger in. It's not just the theological point of belief for me. It is the passion of my soul to see everyone filled with the Holy Ghost. I just came back, it's been 5 weeks now that I was in Tanzania. And we see an awful lot of folks get the gift of the Holy Ghost right here in the U.S. I'm not a big numbers guy. I know some, but I'm not one of those guys that writes down every time someone repents and writes down every number of people that get the Holy Ghost. But I know I'm in the ballpark. Are you okay with that? I'm in the ballpark. And I know that last year from January to June, we prayed with and saw 600 people who had never prayed in tongues that got the gift of the Holy Ghost. But are you ready for this? 300 of them were here in the U.S. Did you all catch what I just said there? Some people look at those great crusades we do in Africa, and they think, well, you have big numbers, so of course you have a lot of results over there. Well, let me tell you, Jesus is the same right here. Well, what would ever make you think he's bigger, greater, more powerful somewhere else? That's an absurd way of thinking. Jesus is great everywhere. Everywhere. Amen. There's no place that he is diminished. There is no place that his power fades. I want you to know, Jesus, I want to say it out loud again, Jesus is great everywhere. Everywhere. He really is. So just from that time frame alone, and I'll tell you, when we were just in Tanzania, here's what we do in our open air crusades. Because we're preaching to how can I say this? I haven't found a good word for it. We're not preaching to church people. We're preaching to street people. When we do these crusades, we put them right next to the marketplace, or we do them right in the sports arena. So we're not dealing with church crowds. There are some church people that are present now, but the bulk of the crowd is going to be just the community, the people. When I say street people, I don't mean homeless people. I'm talking about just people from the community. They are drawn in, and a big part of them will be either irreligious, or they will be, well, where we've been lately, they've been largely Islamic or Hindu, and then you have the tribal religions that take place. But here's the good news. See, Jesus is a healer. He's not just a healer of Pentecostal people. Now you got to listen to this now, because a lot of people don't get this. They think you got to get all the rules right before you can get a miracle. And good God, we've got some rules, don't we? Oh yeah, you got to say it right, pray it right, believe it right. You can't have any doubt at all. If you got just a little bit of doubt, cancels the whole deal. Got to start all over again. I'm telling you the truth. By the time you get a Pentecostal person healed, it really was a miracle. It really was a miracle, because we got all these rules that we put on there. But I found out that Jesus is a healer of people. That's what he is. All right, he's a savior of people. Do you understand that? And so we see a lot of miracles happen, and they happen, believe it or not, in people that are not of our brand. All right, and many of them are not even Christian. Many of them are of other world religions. And we'll see. If you've been to my Facebook, you've seen the picture of the Islamic men and women that are coming, and they're getting healed in those services. And then what we do is we call them to repentance. So that's what we do on Wednesday, Thursday, Friday, Saturday, and then we conclude on Sunday with a great afternoon crusade. But Sunday morning, now we're drawing them in. I bring them into the churches that are supporting that, so there may be a retained harvest. That was an amen spot right there. I got 6 head nods on this side. That's equivalent to 1 full amen. All right. So I'm going to get anything I can get this morning. And then what I tell them all week long is, here's what must happen. You must receive the gift of the Holy Ghost. And that's what I'm going to be ministering on the Sunday morning in the churches that are supporting this. Can I tell you that in Tanzania, the last 2 Sundays, we were in 2 cities, we did 2 crusades events back to back, but we worked them both through to Sunday, and on those Sunday morning services, we prayed with, by the count of the African elders, we prayed with over 500 people that spoke in tongues for the very first time. Come on. Praise God. Praise God. In two days now, but I need to get to the word, but can I just tell you one that was very special to me, and it was in October of last year. We were in Mount Kilimanjaro, Tanzania, and during the course of that crusade, doing the same thing where we're pointing people to Sunday morning where they will receive the gift of the Holy Ghost, and I'll speak in 2 churches that morning and then do the afternoon service, all right? In the afternoon service, there'll be some 900 that will pray to receive Christ as Lord in their life. That is, they'll come to the point of repentance. But in those morning services, we're driving people toward receiving the gift of the Holy Ghost. And the churches, now the crusades are way larger than the churches, and these were nice churches, but they weren't gigantic churches. And we had a number of folks in both of them get the Holy Ghost, but one of them in the second service got the baptism right there in the center aisle. If it was in this place, they'd have been right at this chair right here, and they went under the power. Now let me explain. I believe in going under the power. I've gone under the power many times in my life. It happens in our services, but it's a rarity. It is not a common expression of the Spirit in our services. It does happen. It does happen, but it's not really common in our services. And out of that morning, where we know that in that service we had over 80 that received the gift of the Holy Ghost, she's the only one that went down. And when we were through, when we were totally through and people had received, and I was making the final remarks at the end, she was still praying loud, all right? And tell you the truth, it was a little annoying. Now, I know you don't get annoyed here. I realize that in Louisiana, nothing annoys you. But you know people from New York and other areas that get annoyed. And she was just a little, but here's what you do when you're in a ministry like ours. You can't let anything distract you. So what you do learn to do is tune it out. I mean, if you preach open air crusades like I do, see, when I'm in American churches, we got everything really, really under control. We got nurseries for the babies, you understand, you see. If someone comes in here and is acting inappropriately, then we got bouncers. We call them ushers. They're in disguise. They handle that kind of thing. And we everything's done. We got a nice PA system, all that kind of business, you know, and the electricity is on all the time. But when you're in an open-air crusade in a third-world country, you have electricity, and then it goes off, then you get electricity, and then it goes off, then you get electricity, and then it goes off. And then while you're preaching, the demon-possessed explode. We'll have anywhere from 8 to 16 demon-possessed people just erupt at any point throughout the message, just like that. And then we just carry them out and cast the devils out of them. They'll throw them right up on the stage sometimes, right, while you're preaching. And then the crowd you got aren't church people, so they're moving around, they're talking. Here's the deal. You ever heard of seeker churches? You know what I'm talking about? These guys that they want to organize everything and keep it real tight and so on. If I brought one of those guys to those meetings, those guys would have a panic attack in the first 10 minutes. They wouldn't know what to do because it just is kind of active. We'll put it that way. Well, what you learn to do in those settings is you tune it out. You learn to tune it out and keep your focus on what God is doing in the moment. Are you with me right now? So if she's, a little loud, I just tuned it out and I said what I had to say. And then when I went and sat down, my interpreter, who is a very close friend of mine, we've worked now in Tanzania for 2 years together, and we communicate almost every day. We text back and forth, we talk sometimes, but we are very tight. And I bring him to all of the crusades. I'm even bringing him over into Kenya with me this year for the first time because he's probably the best interpreter I've ever had anywhere. And we've just become brothers like this. And so we're way past the niceties when a message is over with. There's no little, like old nice sermon preacher, or nice altar service. We're way past that kind of stuff. We just talk real stuff. Do you understand what I'm saying? And so when we sat down right after that, and that lady's still praying right out loud, he turns to me and he just says these words to me. He said, he looks at me and says, she doesn't speak English. Yeah, that's what I did. I just stared at him. I said, what? He said, the lady on the floor. Now the bishop is up talking right now. He said, the lady on the floor. I looked and they got her, Africans, they know how to handle church. And they had her now by both arms and they were dragging her down the aisle and putting her behind the last row and the wall because the bishop was speaking. He says, the lady in the aisle, man. He said, she doesn't understand English. See, all of the translations done in Swahili. I said, are you sure? He said, absolutely. I said, ask the bishop. So he went right up and talked to him. He said, ladies, one of your church members, does she speak English? Oh, no, she doesn't know or speak English at all. You see, what happened is she got the gift of the Holy Ghost, and she was speaking in an unknown tongue to her, but not to me. Did you all catch what I just said there? Yeah, she got the gift of the Holy Ghost in English. Good night. Now I got to tell you what. Now the lady that was just a little bit annoying had become the center of my attention. And I got to tell you the truth. I know it was a little rude, but I got right up off that stage right while the bishop was at the pulpit speaking and just walked right down the center aisle, right in front of him. Just walked right down and went right and knelt down in that behind that last row and that wall just to listen to her. Because, see, I tuned her out. Just to listen to her as she prayed and praised my God in a language she didn't know. But catch this, when she spoke, as she spoke in English, are you ready for this? No, you're not ready for this. Are you ready for this? Oh, no, you're not ready for this. Listen, let me tell you what she did. When she spoke in English, she spoke without an African accent. Yeah. Yeah, that pretty well nailed it right there. Because, see, my interpreter is fantastic, and he could preach here this morning, and you'd understand everything he'd say, but when he got through, no one would think he was born in Toledo, Ohio. You'd all know he didn't come from these shores right here, all right? But as she spoke, and interestingly enough, with what I'm going to say American English, because, some of those countries were British colonies at one point, and you'll find that those that will speak in English will speak using British terminology and will speak sometimes even with a British brogue about them. But she spoke in U.S. English. I text my wife right after that, and I said, I says, I feel like, I don't know if this is theologically sound, but I believe it anyhow, so don't try to talk me out of it. As I feel like God did something just for me today. I think he was saying to me, because of your great passion to see everyone filled with the Holy Ghost, let me just give you a little thrill. As I had a true Acts 2 moment where it says, where men had come from all over the world, remember, on the day of Pentecost, and they said, we heard these men speaking in our own tongue. I heard that. I heard that with my own ears. I'm telling you, Jesus is the baptizer in the Holy Ghost. And he's here. Come on, he's here to do a great thing for you. A great thing for you. You say, well, I've already got it, and that's good enough. Then get more. Get more. Because there's more in everything he has for us. Right, there is. There's more in everything he has for us. If you'll stand with me, I'm going to read scripture right now. I'd like you to open to the book of Acts, the first chapter. I'm going to begin at verse 4, Acts chapter 1. Do you love the word? Do you love the word? Acts chapter 1 and verse 4 in the scripture. The moment that you're reading with me is the time in which Jesus has been crucified. He has risen from the dead. He has appeared unto many over a period of 40 days. He is now about to ascend. He's going to leave this world as far as physical sight is concerned, but yet he is still present and with us. Do you believe that? He is that omnipresent God. As he's about to go, he has a word that he wants to share with the people. And he says this, and Luke, as he records Acts, says it this way in verse 4 of chapter 1, and being assembled together with them, he commanded them. Someone say, he commanded. He commanded them not to depart from Jerusalem, but wait for the promise of the Father, which he said, you have heard from me. For John truly baptized with water, but you shall be baptized with the Holy Spirit not many days from now. If you don't mind, for the time's sake, look down to verse 8. But you shall receive power when the Holy Spirit has come upon you, and you will be witnesses to me in Jerusalem and in all Judea and Samaria and to the end of the earth. Now, when he had spoken these things, while they watched, he was taken up, and a cloud received him out of their sight. And while they looked steadfastly toward heaven, as he went up, behold, two men stood by them in white apparel. What are these men? Yeah, they're angels, that's right. Two men stood by them in white apparel, which also said, this same Jesus who is taken up from you into heaven will so come in like manner as you've seen him go into heaven. Did you hear that? This same Jesus who is taken up from you into heaven will so come in like manner as you've seen him go into heaven. Can I tell you that no sooner had he ascended that heaven sent the message, he's coming back again. I believe it. My God, I believe it. I believe he's coming back again. And somehow I got a feeling it won't be long. It won't be long. You may be seated. I got a strong sense that there's going to be an outpouring of the Holy Spirit in just a moment around the front of this place, where people are going to enter and receive the gift of God, and it's going to happen with ease. For those of you that don't even have a clue of what I'm talking about, the Holy Spirit will communicate that to you. You will know it. You will get it. Come on. That's what Jesus does. All right? For those of you that have tried so many times that you've actually developed a spiritual hernia trying to get it, it's going to come with ease today and not with struggle. Will you believe what I just said? It'll come with ease. Trust me, it will. It'll come with ease today and not with struggle. But I'm sensing the flow right now of what is about to happen in the Spirit. And I'm telling you, I'm going to pull a little reverse on us. We're not going to take the offering at the end of the message today. Normally, I would preach, and you know, we receive an offering. It's appropriate, biblically, in fact, to do that. I got to feel that the way the waters are going to be flowing at that time to stop and take an offering is going to be an inappropriate moment. So would you allow me to go ahead and just break protocol in that sense? And you don't have to be preached into to give, do you? Do you have to be preached into to give? I hope not. You don't have to be preached into to give, do you? Why don't we do this? Let's take an offering this morning, right now. Let's take it right now before I get into the body of the message. And this is what I want to do. I'm going to take this offering entirely, this morning's offering entirely, for our African crusades. I'm going back to Tanzania, to Tanga, Tanzania, and then I'm going to be heading right after that city with a full open-air crusade. I'm going into Mombasa, Kenya, a city that is 80% Islamic, 10% Hindu, and then 10% of God only knows what. that's left. It's basically tribal religions and some Catholicism, and the Church of England is what is there. And then there's a smattering of Pentecostals and a few others. We're going into that city. That's going to be the first 18 days of August. And I'd like to take this offering tonight, this morning, and then and we may do something like that again Wednesday. But the rest of the offering is going to be for our U.S. and our family life. All right, you understand what I'm saying? Just making it plain what we're doing. Not this. This offering right now is not for our U.S. crusades or family life in England, what we do in the U.S. This is going to help us reach the nations of the world. So I'm going to ask if you will be generous, be kind, give something significant for the missions outreach that we're about to do in Africa. Let the Lord direct you and speak to your heart. And that way, and I'm going to continue right into the message. Father, would you do this? Would you direct us right now? If we give, as we give, we don't just reach in and just whip something out and throw it in the bucket. May there be a sense now of faith that is connected to what we're doing, a sense of power in connection to what we're doing, because we're going to sow seed in this moment that's going to cause a harvest. I want to pray that again. We're going to sow seed that not only will we thereby receive a harvest, but we're actually sowing a seed that's going to cause a harvest. For your blessing is going to reach hundreds and thousands of people. And it's going to happen in part because of our sowing a seed and connecting with it and making it happen financially with power. Amen. 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 If you're making a checkout, make it to your local church. If you give by credit card or something like that, I think they have a way to do it on their website. If not, we do back at our CD resource table. And, of course, cash can be figured out. All right? Praise God. As you give, release your faith with your giving. Don't just throw something in there. Amen. So what do you mean? I mean, in Jesus' name, give that with power. You know, I want to tell you what, just in Kenya alone, we're in Kenya several times a year, but in Kenya alone, we've never had a crusade, but what there's been at least 5,000 people that have prayed the prayer of repentance. Did you hear what I just said? In fact, last time we were in Nairobi, we had a record of 9,000 people that prayed the prayer of repentance. And in our Burundi crusade that you saw on the video last week, it was over 5,000 per service that were coming and repenting before the Lord our God. That's a great seed. That's a great harvest to sow into. Talking about the Holy Spirit baptism, you notice something in the text that I read today, and it was a very simple text, I'm sure, and I hope at least you were familiar with it, that we notice one thing. The words that we read were the final address of Jesus before he left this world. That tells me something about value, and it tells me something about importance. Let me say it again. The words that we read were the final words that he gave before he left this world. Now think about this, that anything that Jesus says is important. Amen. That was an amen spot again. We're going to have a 101 class on when to say amen. I can see that. Yeah. Anything, oh, you know it, anything Jesus says is important. All right. But sometimes it's not what a man says, but when he says it. Timing that really punctuates the importance. And I look at this and I realize that the word that he gave that day was to receive the gift of the Holy Ghost. And it was his final or parting words. You know, what would you want to say to your friends? What would you say to your loved ones? What would you want to say to this church if you knew that in 30 minutes you were out of here? And I didn't say out of the church building. My God, I'm going to preach more than 30 minutes. You're not getting out of here that quick. I mean, you're off the planet. That's it. You're out here. You're gone. You get what I'm saying? And you got 30 minutes left. What are you going to? What would you do? What would you want to say to your mother, your father, your wife, your children? You get this? There are so many things we'd want to say. Good God, we'd have a list so long it'd take us 16 lifetimes. But here's what we'd do if we had any sense at all. We'd pare that baby down. We would pick out what we think are the highest priorities. And that's what we would share with those that we care about. Listen, you see that happen yet in this world when people find themselves right at an end. It was just what, maybe about 4 years ago, that it was televised all over the nation, where there was about 20 men that were down in a mine pit and it collapsed, remember that? And they were doing their best. They were working feverishly day and night to try to dig down where they could get to them. And they did get a channel open up. I mean, there was a pipeline open up where they could drop down a basket where they could get some notes up from them and such as that. And unfortunately, they never got out of there alive. But here's, when the men begin to send up some notes and such about what was what was on their heart. Here's what you never hear in a moment like that. When you're looking at the end, they didn't send any notes up to their family saying, now make sure, make sure that you get the oil changed on the car. No one sends a note up like that. No one says, remember Saturday we got to cut the lawn. You don't say things like that in a time like that. You say those things that are most passionate and most important. And I look at this and I see he's about to leave this world physically. And what's on his mind? Oh my God, there's some amazing things that have just taken place. I mean, we're talking about the crucifixion. We're talking about the blood being shed, the wrath of the Father being turned away. Come on, we're talking about stripes on his back that have provided healing for all of mankind. We understand that at the cross, Satan was disarmed. His authority, his dominion was stripped from him in that very moment. That's what the blood of the sacrifice did that day. He could have talked so much about these amazing things, and yet that's not where he put his focus. Before he left, he said, there's something that you must know. He says, John talked about it. You've heard me speak of it before. It's going to happen not many days from now, all right? And as he's talking to them about the outpouring of the Holy Spirit, it is at that moment that he actually begins to lift up off the earth. And I thought, oh, God, if this is that important to you, wow, that I need to get my priorities in line. I don't know where you're at, but let me tell you where I'm at. I'm doing the very best I know how not to let Hollywood set my priorities. Not to let the political correct people set my priorities. Not to let American culture define what my priorities are. I am doing the best I know how to go into this holy book and find out what is the passion of our Almighty God. What is it that makes him dance, and what is it that makes him cry? What is it that makes him laugh and shout over, and what is it that breaks his heart? And find out what those things are and make them the passion of my soul as well. And I see this now in this baptism, that the passion of his heart is, as he's about to leave these men, is that every one of them would experience and know and receive this gift of God. Now, I realize that I'm in a group right now that already believes this stuff. That's where I'm at. In most American churches I go to, I don't get to go into the other guys' churches, you know what I mean? They kind of keep me out the door here. But when I preach in America, I'm basically in Pentecostal churches. So I realize I'm around a group that I don't have to establish theologically that there is a baptism of the Holy Ghost. You already get that. That's not the point of this message. The point isn't here to prove to you that there is a baptism. Some churches don't know that. Did you know that? Some churches don't know that. If you speak to their groups, you have to say, well, let me tell you about something that you may not be aware of, but I'm in a group that you already get it. Am I right? Am I in the right house, or did I get in the wrong church? Oh, yeah, okay. I want to make sure I didn't step into the other boys' church here in town. All right, so we already know it, and we know that he's doing it yet right now today. Some churches will tell you, well, that was a historical thing. He did it, but he doesn't do it anymore. But you all know it's happening right now in the earth today, don't you? So that's not where I'm going today. I'm going to just cut right to the chase. I'm just going to talk about how do you get it? How do you get it? Well, we know it's there. We know it's available. We know that God's doing it. How in the world can it happen in our life? And let's face it, there are many of us that struggle in getting the gift. And now hear what I'm saying. I'm not talking about struggle because we don't believe in it. I'm not talking about struggling because we think that maybe somehow that God stopped doing it and it's not happening today in the earth. We're way beyond that. But we still deal with a certain level of struggle in receiving, just receiving that which we already believe and we already embrace. Why does it happen? Well, sometimes it happens because of misinformation or wrong concepts. It could be the result of bad teaching, but in many cases it's not so much it's not bad teaching. It's just that, how can I say this kindly? You know, I live in Dallas, but I was raised in New York, and I'm rude and I don't know it. So I try to get past it, but I'm still working on it. Some of the problem we got is what we've heard from testimony. Not altogether pulpit preaching, but when we listen to people, well, let me just say it to you like this. I've listened to some people testify about getting the baptism of the Holy Ghost, and when they got through talking about it, I wondered what planet they were on when they got it. They embellished in such a way, it was so bizarre, so wild, so crazy. I thought, good God, you know, like what? Where were you when you got this gift of the Holy Ghost? You know, I know people think like that because, I mean, I was in a crusade up in, it was when I used to do multiple week crusades, and I was in a 4-week crusade up in the Pittsburgh area, and we had a night where many, many, many received the gift of the Holy Ghost. I had about 900 in the church, and it was just incredible. We went to 11 o'clock at night, and people were getting the baptism. One of them, extremely special, I'll remember all the days of my life, was a little girl not more than 5 years of age. Not more, did you hear that? Not more than 5 years of age. And she got the gift of the Holy Ghost, and the front was so filled we had to put people on the stage as we were praying with them, and she was on the stage when she got it. And now it was 11 o'clock at night, and she's still praying in tongues. Big time. And so her family finally said, well, we got to get home. So they picked her up by her arms, and she went down the center aisle just like this, out of that big old church, just going right down the aisle, praying in the Holy Ghost big time. I thought, my God, I'll never forget. I'll never forget the picture of that in my mind. Now, but I followed behind her. When I got to the door, there was a young man there that I won't forget either. He was in his 20s, and he grabbed my hand, and he pumped that baby. I mean, he shook hands real hard, and he looked me right in the eye, and he said, I just want you to know that I know I did not get the gift of the Holy Ghost today. I said, well, very good. Good for you. I said, how do you know? Why do you say it like that? And he said, well, because even when you laid your hands on me, I was still conscious. That's what he said. Now, somehow, in his head, he got the idea that when people get the gift of the Holy Ghost, they're kind of like, I don't know, out of their mind. You know? And you'd be amazed, folks that are struggling and getting the gift of the Holy Ghost because they think they got to go into a trance or something. That they think that God's going to, I don't know, they think that God's going to, like, take possession of them like a demon, and they're going to start doing and saying things that they hadn't done. And then after they wake up out of it, their friends will say, you got it. Did I? Yeah. You got it? Well, I didn't even know. That's not it. Now, let me explain. I think this really, what I'm telling you right now, I know this isn't the only struggle, but I know this is a big one because I've discovered that in these 40-some years of ministry. And where it really got nailed through to me was when my father got the gift of the Holy Ghost. Let me tell you a little bit about the Everett side of my family, all right? The Everts came in from the UK back at the very end of the 1700s. And my great-great-grandfather, Everett, was born here on U.S. soil in 1813. And here, and we have genealogy that goes all the way back to him, and just a little bit more that helped us know where we came from in the UK. All right, and so here's what we knew about my great great grandfather Everett. We knew two things about him in the genealogy records. Number one, he wore gray in the war. Oh, some of you just woke up. Oh, my God. Yeah, all right. Yes. Good night. Are there any rebels left in the house anywhere? He wore gray in the war because he lived in Mobile, Alabama. All right. And the other thing we understood is that he had the baptism of the Holy Ghost. He prayed in tongues in the middle 1800s. He said, well, I didn't think that thing happened until almost the 1900s. Oh, good God. The Lord's been doing this ever since the day of Pentecost. There's just been a more widespread outpouring out. But we know this about him, is that he prayed in tongues. And then we know this, that my great-grandfather, Everett, received the gift of the Holy Ghost right at past the middle part of the 1800s, all right? And then my grandfather, Everett, received the gift of the Holy Ghost in 1915 in the Mobile area, where there was a circuit rider preacher coming on through on horseback. There were no Pentecostal churches back then, and he was just hitting from city to city. And so my grandfather and his two brothers got the bright idea that if they tore down one of their four barns and built a building, they could build a church building, and maybe they could talk that guy into becoming a pastor, and they could have a bona fide Pentecostal church. And it became the first Pentecostal church in the Mobile area. All right, they didn't pastor it, they just attended it, but they used their wood to build it, and that man stayed. And my grandfather in 1915 got the baptism of the Holy Ghost. Now let me tell you about my father. My father did not receive the gift of the Holy Ghost until he was 53 years of age. Good night, man. What's up with that? I mean, as far as we can look back, Everett's have been praying in tongues. But my dad didn't, and it's not that he didn't want it or he wasn't seeking it. Oh, Lord, no. I mean, he had come to repentance early in his life, you see, and he was in a Pentecostal church all his life. They laid hands on him. I saw them lay hands on my dad to receive the gift of the Holy Ghost so many times that it's a wonder he had any hair left on his head. They had rubbed him down so hard. But he never, I mean, it just didn't happen. And it didn't happen at all until I was actually full-time in the ministry. I was traveling. I was preaching in southern Ohio, and I got a telephone call on Sunday morning. It was actually Sunday afternoon after the service. A telephone call at my hotel room, and when I picked up the phone, my mother and father were both on the line. All right, now let me stop here for just a second, because I realize I lost everybody under the age of 40 right there, because you're thinking, well, what do you mean they were both on the line? Well, there was a time that we had telephones, and they had wires attached to them, and they went right to the wall. I know you're thinking, there's no way, but it's true, they did. And that wire would run through the wall to different rooms, and you could tie other telephones onto it, and you could pick them up, and everybody talk all at the same time. I know. A bunch of you say, "Nah, he's lying now. He's lying." But no, that's the truth. I mean, come on. How many? Oh, God, let me do something for a minute, and I got to get back to preaching. But how many remember rotary dial? And here now, well, let's really talk about it. How many had a party line in their home? Oh, yeah. Absolutely. But let's get back to the word. All right. But anyhow, my mother and father were both on the line, and my mother spoke up first, and this is what she said. Dale, you'll never guess what happened today. I said, "What's that?" She said, "Dad received the gift of the Holy Ghost." Oh. Okay. Now, the next voice I heard was that of the Lord, and this is the truth. Now, I'm in slightly humorous, but this was really happened. The next voice I heard was his voice, and he said these words to me, "See, I told you I could do it." And when he said that, I realized right then that I had been in unbelief. Because see, if you would have asked me prior to that point, "Do you think your father can yet receive the Holy Ghost?" I'd have given you a great big Pentecostal preacher answer. Absolutely, everybody can have the gift of the Holy Ghost. But in my heart, I was really thinking, if he ain't got it by now, it's just not going to happen. Are you in the room? And I didn't even know that was there. I tell you, I said to my dad, "You got to help me out here. I got to know what in the world happened today. It was so different from all those other times that you would enter in and receive this great gift of God." What he said to me really transformed my ministry. And this is what he simply said. He said, "Tell you the truth, Dale, what happened to me today had happened to me many other times. I just didn't think that was it, so I ignored it." I said, "What?" I said, "Well, what do you mean?" He said, "You know, I'd come up to receive the Holy Ghost. And while I'd be praying, of course, there'd be others there. They'd receive, and they'd fall down on the floor. And they'd do this." And he says, "And I was okay with them doing this. And I was willing to do this. But it never really came across to me like that." So he said, "All I was getting was words that I didn't know and didn't understand, but I didn't get any of this." So I thought, well, I don't know what this stuff is, but until probably not getting anything. So he says, "I kept waiting for this to come, and it never came." He says, "So finally this morning when we prayed, and again, I just kept getting these words, I just thought, maybe I'll say them." And boom, that was it. And then I understood it for the first time. Oh, good night. Not that there's anything wrong with exuberance. Not that there's anything wrong with demonstration. Not that there's anything wrong with falling under the power. I've done it myself. Not that there's anything wrong with jumping or shaking. I've done it myself. But actually what this gift is a communication gift. And you're going to speak with a new tongue. You may or may not twitch. And that's okay. You may or may not do a backflip. That's all right. I'm just glad to be able to get up out of chair at this point in my life. But when I realized that, I realized, oh, Lord, I understand where a lot of folks are struggling right now. They're looking for something that is bizarre and wild, and you don't always come across that way. You don't always come across that way. And sometimes we're writing off our moment because we're not experiencing what someone else is experiencing. Can I tell you today, you know what the Bible says he's going to do? The Word of God says that they spoke with other tongues as he gave them utterance. That's what it says. I'm going to ask you a question. When he gives you utterance, will you say it? You'll be right in the door. So here's what we know about this gift. We know that it isn't necessarily wild, crazy, or bizarre. Here's something else that will help you receive the gift of the Holy Ghost, and that is to know this. Are you ready for this one? You need to know that repentance is the only biblical qualification for receiving the gift of the Holy Spirit. I need to say that right out loud again. You need to understand that repentance is the only biblical pre-qualification for receiving the gift of the Holy Ghost. You see, when folks, especially if you struggled in trying to get the gift, when folks have tried a time or two and it hasn't happened, what happens is either the enemy of our soul, and it doesn't always take the devil, sometimes it just takes some well-meaning Christians, will get you afterwards and say, well, now, brother, I'll tell you the reason why you haven't received, and then they'll start stacking up stuff you got to do, or you have to achieve some kind of spiritual plateau before you can receive the gift of the Holy Spirit. Now, I understand that there's a sanctification process that goes on our entire life, that God is always purifying, increasing, and developing us. You understand that. I understand that. But there is no biblical evidence that people must repent and then climb to some kind of height in Christ Jesus before it's legal for them to get the gift of the Holy Ghost. In fact, what we find in Scripture is that people would repent and receive the gift of the Holy Ghost right on the spot. That kind of thing was normal to take place in one's life. So here's what I want to tell you. If the enemy has told you, or your own mind has said to you, that you need to become a stronger believer, that you need to understand more, that you need to whatever before you can get the gift of the Holy Ghost, that just flat isn't true. If you can look at me and say, here's one thing I know, I have repented before the Almighty God, then I can look at you and say, here, you are ready right here, right now to receive the gift of the Holy Ghost. You really are. You are ready right here, right now to receive the gift of the Holy Ghost. You're all familiar with the passage of Acts 2, 38 and 9, where Peter says, repent and be baptized, every one of you, in the name of Jesus Christ for the forgiveness of your sins, and you will receive the gift of the Holy Ghost. Let me spin out a little bit more, because he says something else there that I want you to notice, and that is this, that receiving the gift of the Holy Ghost is the will of God for everyone. For everyone. Don't ever think, I don't think this church thinks that way, but sometimes I find people that do, that they look at this, especially if they've tried many, many times. If they've tried many, many times, somehow they come to a conclusion that, well, I don't doubt that God's doing it, but maybe he's got something different in mind for me. I'm the unique guy in the bunch. God has some, he's got, I know he did, it for my mother, he did it for my brother, he did it for my wife, but maybe God's got something different in mind for me. Can I help you receive the gift of the Holy Ghost today by simply telling you, this is the will of God for everybody. Literally everybody. Someone say everybody. It's the will of God for everyone who has believed, for everyone that has repented. Again, the scripture says, Peter's preaching, he says, repent and be baptized, every one of you. Did you notice that? He doesn't say, some of you are so good, you don't need to repent. Others, you are so doggone bad, forget it. It just won't work. Here's the good news. There's no one so bad that they cannot be saved. And there's no one so good that they need not be saved. That day, everybody was called to repentance. He made no exception for it. Come on, everybody must come to the point of personal repentance before Christ Jesus. And then, and he has the same thing for water baptism. He doesn't say, and then a few of you, well, you know, we need to dunk you a couple of times too, because, you know, you just been really raw. He doesn't say that. He just calls everybody, come on, into the waters. Are you in the house with me right now? And then he says, and you shall receive the gift of the Holy Ghost. He doesn't say some of you will repent, some of you will even get baptized, but it's not really necessarily everybody. No, he's with the same authority he preaches, and you'll receive the gift of the Holy Ghost. And he goes on to say, for the promises for you. Come on, and for your children. You got this? I'm talking about every, it's the will of God for everybody. And then this is really neat. He says, and for all that are far off. Now, if you understand the Greek wordage there, the language in the Greek does not, when it says far off, does not indicate distance. It indicates time. So he's actually speaking generationally. It's for you, it's for your children, and for all, and he's looking generationally down, and for all that are afar off, even as many as the Lord our God will call. And the call, by the way, in context, is the call to repentance. So he's saying, if he's called you to repentance, here's what you should know. You can have the gift of the Holy Ghost. So come on, quit cutting yourself out of what is actually open and available to you. Don't discount yourself on this thing. Enter in, will you please? If you have repented before him, you are surely ready to receive the gift of the Holy Spirit. Here's another thing that'll help you get the gift of the Holy Ghost, and that's knowing that receiving the gift is easy. Someone say easy. So I said, it isn't necessarily crazy or wild or bizarre. Don't think you have to come over here and do something that is nutso in order for you to get the gift of the Holy Ghost. Hey, if you want to hit the floor, baby, go for it. If you want to roll, roll all you want, you know. In fact, you can roll clean up the wall if you want, but make sure you talk in tongues before you come down. But if you don't necessarily feel like you need to roll or fall or whatever, you don't have to, because it's not necessarily something that is accompanied by, I'm just going to be very plain and use the word weirdness, all right? And I'm going to tell you, it's the will of God for everybody, and it is definitely for everyone who has repented. But now, let me tell you another good thing. It's very easy to get the gift of the Holy Ghost. Now, you may say, well, maybe it was for you, sir, but I'm going to tell you what, I have really struggled with it. No, you're missing what I'm saying. I'm saying it's easy to receive the gift of the Holy Ghost. You say, well, yeah, but you haven't had my experience. No, you're still not listening. I'm saying it's easy. Now, let me tell you what I mean by that. Let me say it to you like this. Believing on the Lord Jesus Christ unto salvation is not hard. It's impossible. Did you get that? Being saved isn't hard. It's impossible. If you try to earn it, if you try to qualify for it, if you try to be religious enough to say, now I'm there, well, you'll never make it. Now, you can bust a gut trying to do it, and you know people that are. You know people that are. You see Christian people that do that kind of thing. That is, when I say Christian people, I don't mean reborn people, but people who will say that they believe that there is a God and that his name is Jesus. And they're trying by lighting candles and doing all kinds of stuff. Are you in the room? To qualify for it. And then you find that really so in other world religions, and Islam is a big one in that way, where they actually go into incredible lengths, even to the point of being willing to kill people in order to go to heaven. Because they're told that by doing these things, it guarantees their way. And I'm going to tell you, getting saved is impossible if you try to do it yourself. But if you'll put all your hope and all your trust in him, if you'll quit working at it and rest in him, you'll enter right into the kingdom. You understand what I'm saying on that now? You get that? Okay. If you understand that, you understand how to receive anything and everything that God is doing. Let me say it again. If you got that, it's the same principle, the same thing that causes you to enter into his healing, all of his gifts, all of his blessings, including this gift of the Holy Ghost. It comes with that type of ease. The more you work at it, and the more you struggle to receive, the farther you turn from it. And I know people, we do this. Now, we don't do it intentionally. We don't say, oh, I'm going to do it all by myself. Oh, God, no, we don't do it that way. We just, you know, we get sincere. If we say, I want it to be all God and none of me, you know. And so we don't necessarily participate with them. We just work at it. We say, all right, Lord, this is it. Today is my day. Today I'm going to get the gift of the Holy Ghost. I'm going to come up there and I'm going to pray it. I'm going to pray it right through. Now, here's my problem. See, before what I did is I prayed for 10 minutes, and I know that's wrong. What I need to do is if I got to pray a whole hour, almost stay here all the way to 1 o'clock if it takes that to get the gift of the Holy Ghost. Well, at 1 o'clock, you'll go out of here disappointed. And then the next time you'll come in and say, my problem was is I put a time limit on it. I'll tell you what I'm going to do. I'm going to stay in there and I'll pray it through if it takes all night long. Yeah. And what you're going to end up with, again, is one of those spiritual hernias. You're going to push and try, but you're not going to get it that way. Because it doesn't happen by doing things hard. It happens by resting in him. Jesus said, my yoke is, oh, don't you ever forget that. My yoke is easy and my burden is light. Absolutely. Yeah. You know, those two generations that got out of Egypt, but only one of them got into the land of promise. Am I right? The first generation died in the wilderness. And the writer of Hebrews tells us why. He said they never entered into the land of promise. And this is the words of the writer of Hebrews. He says, because of unbelief. That's why they didn't get in. Second generation got in. Now you would think he would say, and they got in because of faith. But he didn't say that. He didn't say that. It was that, but he didn't call it that. He said, and I quote him now, he said, they entered into my rest. Oh, wow. In fact, it became a theme throughout the book of Hebrews about entering into the rest of God. And then I understood it for the first time that in the mind of God, rest and faith are synonymous. That if you were to go into heaven and go into God's office and pick up his thesaurus off his desk and open it up, you would find out if you looked in for the word faith, you'd see the word rest in there. And if you looked for the word rest, you'd see the word faith in there, because with God, they're interchangeable terms. That when one comes to Christ, the struggle is over with. Are you hearing that? That when faith arrives within a person's life, the struggle is over with. There comes a rest in him and not a work from me. All right? That makes sense to people, doesn't it? Let me tell you, receiving the gift of the Holy Ghost is easy. So here's what I'm going to ask you to do today when we come up. Especially, now, everyone can do it, but I'm going to especially ask for those who have hit it before. You've tried it many times. Here's what I want you to do. Don't say to yourself, well, now, you know, I know what I've done before. I need to be a little more tenacious at it. I need to push it a little harder. I need to take it over the edge. Here's what I'd rather you do. I'd rather you come up here and remember everything you've ever done to receive the gift of the Holy Ghost, and then don't do any of that today. In fact, here's what we will do. We're going to come around the front in a few moments, and we're just going to begin to worship Jesus. We're going to love on him. We're not going to sing. We'll have a band in the background. Well, the band would be nice to have. But we're not going to sing. We're just going to come and talk to him. We're going to tell him how much he means to us. We're going to worship him verbally. We're going to speak our praise unto him. And then at some point, it may happen to you right away, but at some point, I may ask you just to pray with me to receive the gift of the Holy Ghost. And then when we get through doing that, here's what I'm going to ask you to do. I'm just going to ask you to listen in your heart. Because what's going to happen there is you're going to get a new thought, a new word, a new syllable. See, Acts 2:4 describes exactly how it took place. It says this. You can look at it in the scripture, but I'll quote it. Most of you heard it so many times, you'll know whether I'm quoting it right or not anyhow. And just so that you all know that I'm really ordained, I'll quote it from the King James. It says, and they were all filled with the Holy Ghost and began. But by the way, did you notice something? It says they were all filled. You know what that means? That means everybody can get it. They were all filled. Watch it now. Watch it unfold. They were all filled with the Holy Ghost and began to speak with other tongues. Tongues means languages. Other means languages other than they knew. All right, that's pretty basic, but you all get that already, don't you? They began to speak with other. By the way, who began to speak? Yeah. Everybody did, and they did. They did. It didn't say that God possessed them like a demon, and he began to talk out of them. Didn't say that. I know it's a really crude way of saying it, but that's what a lot of people are expecting. They're expecting God to come and take control of their speech facilities, and that with no action on our part, that this thing takes place. And again, we go into some real, you know, holy thing. We say, well, we just want it to be all God, none of us. But it's never that way. It's never that way. Look, even your salvation, well, he did pay the price. He did shed the blood. He did develop the plan, all right? But you had to come. When he called, hello, when the conviction of sin came, there was a part that you had to play in it. He didn't grab you by the neck and say, like it or not, dude, today you get saved, all right? No. He made the appeal, but you had to come and humble yourself. Am I right? You had to call upon his name. Am I right? You had to believe upon him. Am I right? There was his part. That was our part. Now, our part isn't to make it happen. Our part is just to cooperate. That's all we do. We don't earn it. We don't qualify for it. We just cooperate with him. Does this make sense to you? All right? So here's the part that you play in this. The Bible says that they were all filled with the Holy Ghost and began to speak. So we know they were doing the speaking. They began to speak with other tongues as the Spirit. What did he do? All right. The King James says, as he gave them utterance. And utterance means something to say. Isn't that right? He gave them utterance. He gave them. Now, it didn't say he possessed them and they started and he said things to them. He gave them something to say. This is, look, I'm going to say it as plain and as simple as I know how to say it to you. This is basically what happens to people when they receive the gift of the Holy Ghost. They come, they open their heart to Jesus because he is the baptizer. He is the baptizer. So, I mean, I'll pray with you. I'll lay my hands on you. Maybe some others will. But my God, don't wait for me to come before you open your heart, because I'm not trying to be humble. I'm just stating a fact. I'm not the baptizer. That's just the way it is. I'm not the baptizer. I'll believe with you. I'll pray with you. But I'm not. Don't wait for me. It's really not about me. In fact, if you really center in it all on me, you're going to miss an awful lot. Come on. You'll miss it all. Open your heart to him. And what basically is going to happen is he's going to give you something to say. There's going to come to you a thought, a word, a syllable that you've never learned and you don't understand what it means. Did you all catch that? You've never learned it and you don't understand what it means. When that thought comes, here's what you need to do. Open your mouth and say it. You say, what? Yes. Just, what do, sir? You open your mouth and say it. When he gives you utterance, here, can I ask you to make a commitment to yourself? Make a commitment to yourself right now. That the moment he gives me something to say, I'll say it. Will you make that commitment to yourself? See, it's just that easy. The moment he gives you utterance, the moment he gives you something to say, okay, now wait. We're all human. We do one of two things when God moves on us. We either analyze it or we cooperate with it. Did you get that? We all do that. We all do it. When God moves on us, especially if it's a first time, but truth is, I wish I could say it's only the first time. I got to tell you, in my experience, and I'm talking about Dale Everett here, I still do it. I still have, not necessarily with tongues, but I still have moments where God moves on me, and the first thing I think is that really God? Is that really the Lord? Or will that really work? Or whatever. It's just human nature. When God moves on us, we do one of two things. We either analyze it, or we cooperate with it. Now look, if you analyze it, you're going to get hung up right there. And let me explain why. Because this thing will come to your mind, but it does not come from your mind. It comes from your spirit, because that's where he is. Are you in this room right now? That's where he is. So when these tongues come, these words come, they don't come from your experience. They don't come from your education. They don't come from your training. They don't come from a language bank that you're familiar with. They come to your mind, but they didn't come from your mind. They come up from your heart. And your mind's going to want to grab it right there and say, dude, where did that come from? What is that all about? I don't understand that. What is that all about? And he wants to stop it until he understands it, until he can pigeonhole it, put it somewhere where he's comfortable with it. And let me tell you, if you sit there, you'll never open your mouth and say what God just gave you. But if you'll make the commitment to yourself right now, that the moment he gives me something to say, whether I'm not going to understand it, I'm not going to get it, but that's okay. The moment he gives me something to say, I'll say it. If you'll make that commitment, you'll enter right into it. If you sit there and analyze it or sit on it, you'll go the rest of your life trying to get this gift. It's already there if you'll open your heart and your mouth together and worship him with it. Did that make sense to everybody? Now, would you stand with me all over the room right now? Stand with me all over the room. I believe there's great faith for this. Now, here's what I know about the gift of God. Every gift of God is similar. And that is that no one has ever received and how can I say it, and exhausted the blessing and the benefit out of any one thing that God has done for us. Let me say it again. No one has ever received and exhausted everything that's in any one thing that God has done for us. In everything he's done, there is exceeding more. Man, I need to say that out loud again. In everything he's done, there's exceeding more. And if you think you got it all, well, you need to reach in a little deeper, because there's more. Wow, there's way more in everything that Christ has done in us. So here's what I want to do this morning. I want to pray with two separate lines of people. I'm going to have two lines. I'm on a first line that's going to come real close to the stage. You can can put your toes touching the stage if you want, right close to the front, if we need to, from wall to wall. And then in a moment, just a moment, at the same time, I'm going to form a second line, and it's going to be right behind those folks. Let me tell you where the distinction is on the lines. The first line is going to be for those who say, Dale, I've never prayed in tongues, but I'd like to. And I haven't done it yet, but I'd like to, all right? And if that's your hearts, then I want you right in the very first line. Then in a few moments, I'm going to ask for those of you to say, now, Dale, I have prayed in tongues, but I want more. Is there any more people in the house? I'm in that line right there. I want more. I want more. And I'm going to have you right behind them, right behind them. And then what we're going to do is we're just going to take, I want you to mellow out and relax. Don't you be in a rush now. Mellow out and relax and just begin to love on Jesus. Won't take forever, but I want you to worship on the Lord because he's the baptizer. If you don't become cognizant of him, it'll be very hard for your heart to open up and hear the words that he's about to give you. So he's the focus. Get your attention right on him, all right? Love on him, magnify him. You say, well, Dale, I've never done much like that. I'm not much of a vocal guy. That's okay. This is a good day to begin. It really is. It's a good day to begin. When you come, I don't want you to think your praise. I want you to speak your praise. You don't have to scream it. You don't have to shout it. It's okay if you want to, but it's really not the point. You don't have to scream it or shout it, but I want you to start vocalizing. I'm especially talking to those who have never prayed in the Spirit before, because here's a real simple thing that I didn't cover, but I'll bet you can get it real quick. You can't talk in tongues with your mouth shut. Did y'all get that? You can't talk in tongues with your mouth shut. And then I'm going to tell you something else that's equally important for you to understand. You can't talk in tongues and English or Spanish at the same time. Did y'all hear what I just said there? Some people struggle in getting this gift, and the reason is because they will praise God in the language they know, but they will not stop. At some point, when we're worshiping up here, this is where I'm going to get a little different than classical Pentecost. At some point, I'm going to stop y'all. I'm going to ask everybody that's speaking in English or any known language to stop what they're saying and just to listen. Because you're going to catch the utterance when you stop talking what you know. Did y'all hear what I said? I'm not going to tell you that's the only way it could happen, but I do know one thing for sure, that if you know multiple languages, you can't speak in them simultaneously. Now, basically, I speak in English. Some people would question that, but that's what I'm speaking in. And mimi nina fahamu ki Swahili kidogo. I know a little bit of Swahili as well. But I will tell you that I cannot speak in Swahili and in English simultaneously. If I'm going to speak in Swahili, I got to stop talking in English. And if I'm going to speak in English, I have to stop speaking Swahili. Do you all understand what I've just said there? The struggle some of us have had in getting the gift of the Holy Ghost is we spent the whole day just shouting and praising God in English. And then we wonder why we didn't get the gift. I know why. We never shut up. At some point, I'm going to ask you, come on, no more known language. And the minute I say that, then that means no French, no Italian, you get me? No English, no Spanish, no Portuguese, or whatever it is you might also know. None of that. And just listen. I know that's not classical Pentecost. Some of us think if we're not shouting or speaking or praying, we're not doing anything. But let me tell you, if you'll just soak in the presence of Jesus, he's just good to sit at his feet. You don't have to be saying anything at all. And right about that time, if you'll listen carefully, and you don't have to, it's not going to get weird on you. It's just going to be a thought that'll come in your heart. It's not going to blow you across the room. It'll just be a thought that'll come in your heart. When that new word comes, that's your cue. That's your cue. Right then, open and say it. Will you do that? All right, those that have never prayed in tongues and you'd like to, would you come real quick up here right now? Come right now. Come up here real quick. Look, I got a brand new breath mint, and I'm going to put it in. It's safe to come. It's safe to come. Beautiful. Keep the lights up. I want to see what's happening in the house. Don't leave me in the dark. Stay standing if you will, if you can. Stay standing if you will. All right. If you need to sit down because of pain or something, do that. But if you've never prayed in tongues and you want to, come shoulder to shoulder right across the front. Come shoulder to shoulder right across the front. All right. Now, those of you that say, Dale, I have prayed in tongues, but I want more. Would you come behind them? Would you come behind them? You prayed in the Spirit, but you want more. Give me some space. Don't come physically right up on them. Give me some space. I want to have two lines that I want to deal with, all right? Thank you, sir. I appreciate that. Now, you got where we're going on this? Relax. if you tense up, you'll probably miss it. So let me tell you, the way that our West Coast brethren understand that you approach this thing, and our brethren from the islands, Jamaica and such, they understand this, that what you got to do is you got to mellow out, dude. All right, gotta mellow out, and that's what you do. Enjoy the presence of the Lord, and let's just speak our praise to Him in language we know. Tell Him that you love Him. Tell Him what He means to you. Say, I'm not sure what to do. Well, if you've repented, say thank you for forgiving me of my sin. Thank you for caring about me. Thank you for having mercy on me. Just bless Him like that, and enjoy His presence now. Just enjoy the presence of the Lord. Warm up. Something miraculous is about to happen. There's going to be a change in the atmosphere in just a moment. It's already mounting right now. And I'll know it, and you'll probably pick up on it too. But I'll know it right away. And that's when we're going to ask Him, come on, give us now the gift of the Holy Ghost. And when we finish with that, don't you dare speak any more language you know. You say, well, what if I don't get anything? Well, then don't worry about it. Just enjoy His presence and soak there. You don't have to say anything. Just soak. I don't care if it's for a long time, but I don't think it'll be a long time. Just soak in His presence. If you get some words before we ever get to that point, then just go for it, man. Don't wait for me to pull the plug, all right? But let's just love on the presence of the Lord now for a while. Let's love on Him. You don't have to be extreme. Just tell Him He means something to you. Come on, lift your hands if you feel comfortable doing that, and let's praise the name. Let's praise the name that has saved us. Let's praise the name that has redeemed us. Let's praise the name that's given us all hope. Oh, Jesus. You're everything we want right now. You're all that we desire. You're the glory, the majesty, the wonder of it all. You're the savior of our soul. You're the healer of our bodies. Will someone praise Him with me? Just vocalize your praise. No singing for a while. Just vocalize your praise. It's all right to speak it right out loud. Tell Him how much He means to you, because you do. You mean everything to us. You are all of our hope. You're all of our salvation. You're all of our healing. Come on. You're all our strength. That's who you are. That's you are the peace that passes all understanding. Come, let's worship Him. Come, let's worship Him. Be responsive. That's how your gift opens up. Everything opens up with your response. We worship you, King of Kings. We worship you, Lord of Lords. We magnify you, most holy God. Elo, 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 shangoro mandakai. There's an anointing that's beginning to rise right now. Come on, church. Come on, church. Bless His name. Don't be afraid to do it. Bless His name. He's good. He's worthy. He's the King. Oh, Lord, we praise you. Oh, Lord, we worship you. Oh, Lord, we magnify you. For you alone are God. I'm telling you, there's a well that's starting to rise in Jesus' name. There's a well that's starting to rise. Oh, Lord, I will bless your name. I bless you, great baptizer in the Holy Spirit. John spoke it of you, and we've experienced the truth of this. One would come who would baptize us with the Holy Ghost and with fire. You are that one, and I bless you. You are that one, and I exalt you. You are that one, and I magnify you. Jesus, Jesus, Jesus. That's it. Begin to talk to Him. Make it between you and Him. Oh, look to me. Come on. Get your attention on Him entirely. He's it. Oh, Lord, we bless. Oh, Lord, we bless your name. You that are behind them that have already received the gift of God, just begin to praise Him in the Spirit. Just begin to praise Him in the Spirit, because it's already starting right now. Look, she's already got it. It's already happening right now. God's pouring out of His Spirit. Come on, praise Him in the Holy Ghost. Let's have an atmosphere of spiritual praise. Praise beyond our understanding. Rambo Roboko Shatobasitai. You're right on it, girl. Go ahead and receive. Speak right out the words that God gives you in Jesus' name. Come on. It's already beginning with people. Let's pray together. You that are in the front, pray it with me right now in English. Say this with me. Jesus. Say it with me. Jesus. I'm opening my heart to you and receiving from you now the gift of the Holy Spirit. and I will worship you with the new words you give me. As you give me utterance, I will speak that praise to you. Come on, let's do it right now then, in the name of Jesus. Be filled with the Holy Ghost. No more English now. Don't struggle, just relax. But the first thought you get, say it right out loud to him. Chepasha. There you go. Pamokundo. No English at all. In Jesus' name, you got faith on you right now. Zero in on it and say what you got. Rakomoshato. Yeah, come on, Amakuto. Get good, 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 good. Praise God. Come on, church. Come in close. You that want them more. Come in close and begin to pour out on them in the name of the Lord. Don't struggle now. Don't look around. Look to him. No more known language. In Jesus' name, receive the gift of the Holy Ghost. Sapotasha. Arabokato. There you go. There you go. You got it right there. Just say the word you got. Masuka. Okay, good, good, good. Good. Korobokuto. Good, good, good. That's it. Now use your lips and your tongue. That's it. You do it together. Shahamandiko. Ra, ra, ra. Diko sokoto. Look at this. Come on. It's happening right there. In Jesus' name. Somdo. Somdo. Forget everything else that you focused on and look only to this now. Mashomondika. Now don't be afraid to say that thought. You got it right there, Jeff. There you go. Porokoto. There you are. That's it. That's really it. That's what it sounds like. Come on. That's it right there. That's it right there. Now more. There's more of that. Poroboshako. Parabi. Parabi. That's how easy it is. Come on. Look at this. It's really happening. Come on. All the way. You got it. You got it right there. That's it. Now there's more. There's more in everything. You too. Look at it. I can see it on you, girl. Rashatabokata. Machoto. Bitikon. Good, good. Sabutukoto. Good. Now there's words, all kinds of words there. Go for every one of them. Maloshato rebiti. Lift both your hands and just say what you got. Whatever's coming to your heart right now. You got it on you right now. I can see it. Good God. Just say what you got. Shabarabasatai. You say, well, preacher, that's a different way. We've not seen people pray that way before. Look, that's what you do. You speak with new words. Rashokomondo. There you are. That's what it sounds like, girl. That's really it. That's really it. It's truly happening. Come on. Boy, there's power all over you, dude. Makushati. Makushati. What do you got? Just say that right out loud. Rakomondo. Yeah. Harabito. Zongo. Zongo. Zika. Yeah, Rabakoshata. Good, good, good. Now don't be afraid of the thought you got. You got the real deal. That's not fake. What you got is real right there. In Jesus' name. He's getting good. Robokobuchata. There you are, man. That's it. That's it. Now there's more. There's all kinds of sounds in there. There's more. You got it right there. Come on. Good God. Come on. People are getting the Holy Ghost. Look at you, dear. There's such power on you. Faith of God is on you guys right now. In the name of Jesus, relax. Enter into his rest right here. First thought you get, say it right out to him. Don't analyze it, just say it. Chapoti. Don't say what I say. Don't say what I say. You got a thought. This is just how simple it comes. What I got. Pokondi. Pokondi. Andorabato. That's it, guy. That's it right there. That's it. You got right in. That's it. Now there's more, but you got it right there. That's how it is. Look at that. Come on. He just entered in right there. Come on. He's got it big time right there. Come on, church. Praise God. Lay hands on him and agree with him. Bless him right now. You've got favor on you. You've got power on you. Marabashata. Look at this. Look at this. Look at this. Oh, come on. Praise God. Yeah. Amen. There's an anointing here. There's an anointing here. Jesus. It's all over you, dear. It's all over you. Just relax. Just relax. And just whatever he gives you, don't push it. Just relax. Feel beautiful. Beautiful. Now you're not wasting your time. You're tuning right in. You're tuning right in Jesus' name. Let's pray with her, saints. Gently, but pray with her. The power of the Holy Ghost is right on her. Elo, elo. That's it. Now use your tongue. Use your lips.
Receive what he's giving you in Jesus' name. Bele ishito moho. There you go. Go it again. Right out loud. The new word. Marabokuto. Se, se, morabokatai. No English at all. My dear, receive the gift of the Holy Ghost. Be filled, my brother. Mela, 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 usharabata. See, in the New Testament, they commanded them to receive the Holy Ghost. It doesn't mean they stood up there like a drill sergeant and yelled at them. They're doing just what I'm doing right now. Say what you got. Say what you got. Not English. What is the new thought you're hearing? Maloquito. Good. Yeah, add some volume to that. Phrase them right out loud. But no English at all. No English at all. In Jesus' name. Oh, you got a sweet spirit about you. It's good. There'll be more to come, but right now, use what you got. That's good. Both of you, if you don't mind, lift your hands and just say those words to him. No English. Not for a while. Mahriko. Mahriko. That's it. The words you got. Good, good, good. Now, don't doubt those words. Don't doubt what God's giving. He's giving you utterance. You're saying it. Continue to do that in Jesus' name. Say a, see a, see a. Oh, Ramandiari Shatara.